Need a presenter? Your Event Audio has you covered. Closed circuit audio equipment with turnkey operation at your trade show booth, live event, or private event. YourEventAudio.com is the place to go. DJ services, MC talent, and a whole lot more. Check out YourEventAudio.com today.
Craving ideas to ignite your face-to-face marketing program? Join us at Exhibitor Live, the conference and exhibition for trade show and corporate event marketers in Nashville, February the 25th through the 28th. Dive into over 100 electrifying sessions and workshops led by industry rock stars, where you'll learn to skyrocket your ROI, master the art of creating experiences, and forge connections that will take your program and your career to the next level. Secure your spot now and turn your trade show dreams into reality at exhibitorlive.com.
Well, a packed month of January with trade shows and live events is what we're in the middle of right now as we embark on our third edition of the Exhibitor Now podcast here on this January 19th, 2024. I'm Mike Morrison, National Sales Director for WS Displays. You see on your screen, Mark Johnson joins me from Las Vegas. And Mark, CES, Promotional Products Show, NRF, those are in our rearview mirror now, all showing tremendous positive feedback from the shows, and many industry eyes will now turn to World of Concrete, SHOT Show, PGA in Orlando, as well as we certainly can't overlook Surfaces coming up in Vegas and NAMM in Anaheim. The month is chock full of shows, and it sets the expectation that 2024 is really kicking things off on a high note.
Yeah. Again, I think we talked about it with CES and Emily, and that's our editorial team at CES in particular. Both of us experienced all the way until 4 p.m., the end of the show, people were still standing in line, including myself and Emily, 20 minutes to experience an activation. So the crowds, not only did I feel that they were greater than years past, but they were consistent through the whole week of the show. So that was great. We're seeing a lot of attendance for all of those. And yeah, they're expecting, you know, similar kind of results for World of Concrete and SHOT here. It is interesting. I've got a new business partner I'm working with out here in Vegas that we'll talk about later, but he's got an inside track to what's going on from a casino perspective. And that the one down number that he got from CES, the number of gambling, the dollars gambled during CES was 23% less than last year. So gambling was down, which I thought, wow, I thought that was a recession-proof kind of vice, you know, with it that you still gambled. But the casinos weren't as happy with CES as we were as an industry and stuff like that. So interesting, different measurements, different perspectives make a difference. So
a couple of things there. Do you think that would be because people were busy at the show and they had so much going on with so many people coming back? Maybe it was the length of time that it took to get from point A to point B with all of the influx of people. And then the other thing is, I saw the number, I don't know if it's official or not, but the number I saw was 135K of attendees. And you thought that would be much higher than the 130 they anticipated. It'll be interesting to see if it even was higher, what the audited amount would be. But it's an interesting thought that there is less gambling, because usually the show floors are packed with badges of people who are doing their gambling thing.
Yeah, no, and I think I said on our last podcast too, I was outside of town, a half hour at different restaurants and stuff, and to see the badges out there, the people were totally spread out over the city for hotel rooms and such, obviously. And maybe it was a cost savings. Maybe it's a message to the casinos that don't totally mark up your room rates just because it's CES, because they do have options and they're willing to drive. And maybe it was also the, back to what we've talked about, the quality of the consumer. The people who are coming with a business purpose, and gambling was secondary, and maybe they did or didn't do it. But yeah, I know with our clients that they had less time for that. And to be honest, one of our clients took the day to go hiking versus the casino. So they wanted to get out into Red Rock and some of the areas with that. So maybe it's back to the experiential. You know, we've done enough gambling and I can do that, but I want to experience some other things when I'm there. So it's interesting perspective. We'll have to do a little more digging on the data.
That would be interesting data because that makes Las Vegas roll. It makes the machine move. Is the pictures of dead presidents going into machines and on gambling tables. Interesting thought. Yesterday on our initial 2024 podcast for the Association and Advocacy Focus, it was highlighted that there's a new coalition, a collective, if you will, starting between six associations with the ECA included, known as the Exhibitions Industry Collective. So I had to skip that recording due to meetings, but maybe you could give us a little bit of Reader's Digest review on why this is happening and what that initiative and collective will be doing for the industry starting in 2024.
Yeah, the short version is a lot of these associations with ESCA, EDPA, IAEE, Tommy's involved with it too, with everything that's happening with it. They're working on the same initiatives. So everybody's, as an example, the big one we talked about was the workforce. All of us are trying to figure out how to solve this workforce problem. And again, if you can bring the collective efforts together and resources and focusing on it, we're going to be much more successful as an association. And that's their mindset behind it, is they've been working, hey, they talk to each other, they're helping and supporting each other. You're working on that too? How do we work together to get more effectiveness and ROI on all the stuff with it? That's the big purpose of this group. They're committed executive leaders, they're committed to the organization. And now they're just trying to work together on the issues that are focusing on our industry and how do we make everybody more successful and help the industry perform better.
Interesting concept. Yeah, it happens a lot. You end up having discussions with two association, and then you find out you're actually working on the same thing. You might even be working against each other and in possibly being an obstacle for the other organization to get to where they need to. So it's good to work in conjunction with each other after the same goals.
Yeah. And Mike, the issue there too is I got to commend them because what I've seen over time is what gets in the way is people's ego. You know, we want to be the association or we want to be the leader in this and let's us go solve this. So no, they put all that aside. And when you can do that, we can all be more successful. Let's just make sure we work together. And again, Exhibitor is going to do everything we can to support these guys and broadcast their message. They are creating their own website. So we'll announce that here soon when that comes out, where we can get more information. But all of the associations also have agreed to put a link from their association website to this new Exhibition Industry Collective's website, what's going on. And Exhibitor Live, we're going to do the same. And we're also getting a forum together for them at the upcoming Nashville show to make sure they've got a chance to be on stage and talk a little bit about what's going on.
It seems Exhibitor Group is trying to be, in my eyes, the Switzerland of the group, trying to make everybody come together. It's going to be interesting and seeing that develop. Matter of fact, off mic, we're talking about some people who may have walked away or coming back. And that's always a good thing if you can get more and more people out there chanting your initiatives. You'll attract more people. So it'll be fun to watch how that develops here over the next month or so as we get closer and closer to Exhibitor Live. We're going to wrap up with this bullet point. I thought this was interesting. I don't see this one a lot. When I read this headline, I'll be honest with you, I was drinking something and I almost spit it out of my mouth. It was that impactful on me when I read it. The ultra wealthy had a message this week for political leaders at the World Economic Forum in Davos, Switzerland. And the message was raise our taxes. Over 250 multimillionaires and billionaires signed an open letter calling on elected officials in attendance to tax the rich and turn extreme unproductive private wealth into an investment for our common democratic future. Notable signatories included Disney's heir Abigail Disney and Valerie Rockefeller, a couple of names you might recognize. The plea comes after Oxfam International predicted earlier this week, get this, that the world will see its first trillionaire within a decade. Now, Mark, that sounds really nice on the surface, but I find in a general statement, people who have the money and make the money really want to hold on to the money. Or they want to invest in their own ventures. They want to make their business or organization better. And by doing that, you reinvest and you make it better. Taxing us? taxing them? Not so much. What's your thoughts on that?
You know, first of all, I commend you, Mike, for you're going to be the first trillionaire in a decade here. So I'm looking forward to seeing you in the press on that one. I think you're right on to something with that. We all are working to create and survive when we start out. It's the hierarchy, Maslow's hierarchy. Once we get our needs met, and with Disney and Rockefeller and some of these others that have gotten to that point, even Warren Buffett has said that here in the U.S. He's doing the same thing. He's given all of his money away. I've got enough. And once you get to that point, you do want to become more democratic, or what can I do for what's my legacy going to be? And how do I feel good about helping others? And I see some of the biggest philanthropy work done by the people who've got the biggest amount of money. And they really are giving back with it. The challenge is when you have some of the well-to-do, they also have not only the money, but they have a lot of the power. So they can work into the government and control their taxes. Don't tax me, or because they have a little bit bigger voice. But I think the real good ones, the strong ones, and the more confident ones are the ones that can get to the other side and go, you know what, realistically, there's more I can do, tax me, and then use the money wisely. And I think that's where the challenge always does come into is, okay, tax me, but I don't want to pay $10,000 for a hammer. You know, how do we get around some of these things in government spending or whatever that happens to play with it? But I do think you're going to see more and more people continue to give back. The world needs a lot of help in a lot of areas. And I think it's great that someone's doing this. And I think we'll continue to see more of it. I just think as we're getting older, people are looking to do more of a legacy versus I've already got what I need, you know, or trying to hang on to what they've got. There's areas that they can do to help others. So I wish I was one of the had that extra money and be a trillionaire, but you could really give more. But I feel really good about what I do and our organizations do and how we do give back, because you got to do what you can to make the world better.
Somehow or another, I see that open sign letter by all that 250 billionaires and trillionaires is going to wind up somewhere in Washington, D.C. before the week is over with. And or at least those governments around the world, and they're going to have that as proof. It'll be interesting to watch. I just, like I said, thought it was an interesting story. Also interesting for this week's show is our interview at this time. Nicola Kastner is known in the event world as the event strategist. She has a tremendous resume of doing event planning and execution for various large companies, including SAP, which was her most recent run, and before opening 2 years ago, this organization that she self-runs, and she assists people with their strategies and how they conduct events. So I had a great sit-down conversation with her for this week's show. Take a quick break and come back with the talk with Nicola Kastner after this.
Are you searching for trade show and event products and services? Find it on Exhibitor Exchange is your complete buyer's guide to trade show exhibiting and events, featuring the trade show industry's top exhibit and display providers. Find it on Exhibitor Exchange is the industry's best shopping and commerce resource for buyers and sellers of exhibit and event products and services. Reaching 20,000 exhibit and event buyers in every print issue of Exhibitor Magazine and 140,000 exhibit and event buyers online each year. Search the listings or list your company today. Learn more at exhibitoronline.com/findit.
Welcome back to the Exhibitor Now podcast. Really been looking forward to this one. As we said in last week's show, budgets right now, even though we're pedal to the floor on events, trade shows, expos, conventions specifically, and as well as experiential events of all types, the challenge has always been pictures of dead presidents. It's always about the budget. And so today, as I said in last week's show, I came across this article from Skiff Meetings, which we'll talk about in a second. I'd like to introduce our guest first and give her the credence for taking time out. We're a little earlier in the week, taking her vacation time, actually, a day off to talk with us here on Exhibitor Now. That would be Nicola Kastner. Now, many people on the event side know her because she is, we were chatting back and forth the other day, and she made a statement that I can really resonate with, and that's we both live in social media right now. We both are buried in LinkedIn and all the other social medias that are out there, and that's what I've been watching is a lot of her social media posts, which I know some of you do as well.
I know she's been on a couple of other podcasts that I'm familiar with, so I know she's out there on the circuit. But her organization is known as the Event Strategist, which is, if you look at her resume, it is very significant. The last 4 years before opening this organization in 2022, she was the vice president of global head of event strategy for just a small company, SAP, in Greater New York. And now she resides in her Toronto, Canada area. She comes to us today in that home office. And once again, I appreciate you, Nicola, taking time and just chatting with us about this article. And I hope you're doing well. I know you got a little bit of a cough, but yeah, you look great. And I'm sure you're going to do just fine today.
Thanks, Mike. Thanks for having me.
So let's talk about this article. I mentioned it last week. It was in Skift Meetings, and it was entitled, Will Negative U.S. Consumer Sentiment Keep Event Budgets Low? And as you delve down deeper into the article, this is where Nicola comes into the discussion. And the subheading in the article is entitled, The Impact on Meeting Budgets. And I'll just read verbatim. Unfortunately, event budgets in North America do not appear to reflect a positive outlook on the economy. Here's her quote. While the economy might be picking up, I don't think marketing budgets are picking up at the same rate. This one is huge. You estimate that the cost of events is roughly 30% higher than in 2019. We use that benchmark a lot these days. But marketing budgets have remained flat for years. This isn't something new. And you finalize with, we're essentially asked to do more with less. So that's the battle, right? That's a huge battle for all of us, especially from the display side and from other sides. Let me go into that and pick your brain a little bit. So you get this challenge, I'm sure, a lot. You know, they want us to do this event and I've got an X budget and it's small and it's not big enough. Let me turn the mic over to you. How do you address this with prospective and current clients in this element in 2024?
Well, I think it really comes down to understanding the goals, right? What are you trying to achieve? If you know that, you can design an event and outcomes for success. If you don't know that, you can be creating experiences that don't necessarily move the needle or resonate with the audience. So starting with the end in mind is incredibly important. And it's also, you know, understanding the needs of the attendees. So what does success look like for the organization? What do the attendees need out of the event experience that you're designing? Those foundational elements can lead to a lot of decisions about what you include in an event, how you design the event, and so forth. So if you're being asked to do more with less, which we all are, it's a common thing, I think we have to focus on that value. What is the value that this is going to drive for the organization, for the attendees, or so forth, and double down on the spend there versus just spending it, sort of spreading the peanut butter so too thin, maybe.
That's an interesting and such a common sense statement, okay? If I sit there and listen to that, I would imagine, and once again, I'm just guessing here, that a lot of your clientele might be a culture, an older culture, of how they've gone to an event a certain way. And it's you may hear this a lot. Well, we've always done it like this. And, you know, I don't know if that's right or wrong, but as a strategist, the event guru, as you are, the event strategist, it would seem that you would know by data, by strategy studies, and even accomplished events that your strategies have been implemented, and you come back and you show, this is successful. We've done this. But are you getting, do you ever get pushback from that when you present that to a prospective client that, hey, you need to really know your goal and your roadmap before you even step into the world of this event?
Yeah, those words, we've always done it this way. The most dangerous ones in the English language, I think. You know, the world is changing. Everything is changing rapidly. And so should our events, quite frankly. You know, I'm not the same person I was 2019. I'm not the same person I was last year. My use, we were just chatting before we started recording about the use of ChatGPT and how we're using that in our jobs and day-to-day. You know, I wasn't doing that 6 months ago. So, you know, the world's totally changing. So I think, yes, we get pushback. I get pushback sometimes, but it's not usually from my clients. It's from internal stakeholders, right? That, you know, I want my stage. I want, you know, whether it's sales that want to bring their customers, you know, it's an executive that wants to tell the story, which of course they have every right to, but it doesn't have to always be done in the same way. And you know, I often use an example where if you take your keynote and you look at the way that you've been running your keynote at an event, let's just use that as an element. Companies have been running the keynote in the same way for the last 10, 15 years. And, you know, most of them are on YouTube these days. You know, you can find them, go back and look, you'll see the exact same format. You'll see a few more women these days, but that's about the only thing that maybe is different. So, you know, the world's changed, events have to change as well. So it's really about helping my clients tell the story internally to their stakeholders as well about, you know, here are examples of what other companies have done that have driven impact. Here are where we can change and refine what we're creating to drive greater outcomes. So I think, I'm a data nerd. I lead the data. I tell data-driven stories. And I find that those really resonate in helping convince the right people to make the changes that they need.
Do you see... For a while there, it seemed like events were turning into television shows almost. It was all about the entertainment factor. It was right there at the top. I saw a lot of that coming out in event changing methodology. Is that still a thing, or have people even gotten more creative and maybe gotten more interactive? Instead of me at you in an event, it's me with you. And let's see how much we could have interaction and involvement, inter-involvement, which leaves the the attendee with a little more positivism about the event. I know it's a stretch, but I guess I'm just trying to figure out what I've seen in the past with events and what may be happening now to take a flat budget and turn it around to have some experiential value to it.
Yeah, I think ultimately, you know, there's the great debate. What's more important, content king, experience king? I think value's king, quite frankly. And so value for the organization, value for the attendee. So, you know, I'll go back to where I started. It's about driving value. I think events are changing. Some are not. They, to your point, they've been very much monologue driven. And they should be dialogue. There is no better opportunity than an event to get face-to-face with your customers and your prospects and to really understand them and their business needs and their business challenges. So yes, I'm starting to see a shift into more dialogue, more interactive experiences that create those conversations, not just company to attendee, but attendee to attendee. I mean, that's why we go to events, right? Like, that's one of the core reasons. So, you know, in the past, we're talking about budgets, right? And how do you make your budget stretch further? This research showed that people actually are looking for speakers. Let's talk about, say, a keynote speaker that's going to provide inspiration and is relevant to them. Only 1% of attendees said celebrity speakers were important. So, you know, simple things using data can inform decisions that will A, save budget, but also add greater value to your attendees. So I'm hoping, long-winded answer to your question, but I am starting to see a change. And once again, it really comes back to driving that value.
We're seeing a lot in culture change right now. If I can piggyback on that a little bit, when I go to a lot of association meetings that I'm involved with, DEI is at the top. Or at least near the top. It's probably in the top three. And other cultural aspects, just the culture itself changing. We're seeing a lot more of the me time, more for me, more self-help, for lack of better words, and other things like how are those and maybe some others playing into the change of the event spectrum with planners as they go forward? Are you seeing a somewhat of a uniform change where all of this is included, maybe with some other points? Or, you know, is it other ROI value checks and balances that people look for?
No, I mean, I think sustainability, D&I, all of that, that's table stakes. That's expected now. So, yes, I mean, it has to be leading throughout the planning process. You know, you have to, has to be top of mind. I feel like the pace of work accelerated so much during COVID, and it hasn't slowed down even post-COVID as we're coming out this side of the pandemic. People are returning to the office and so forth, but if they're not in the office, they're still expected to be online and be connected, right? So what I'm a huge advocate for, which is also, you know, going back to our budget conversation, can have a direct budget implication, is you need to build free time into the agenda so people can check the calls, respond to emails, do whatever they need to do, which means you don't have to jam your event full of content and things at any given time, right? So I think allowing that flex time, I think sorting your content later in the day is also really impactful in driving a better experience for your attendees, because they're able to get some work done before they actually come into the event, and then they can stay focused. I think events that can cater to the whole person, so not just the business needs, but also their personal needs, are going to be more successful. We're the same person in our business life as our day life, right? You know, we have the same values, we have the same expectations. So any event that can cater to that is going to be more impactful.
Very interesting. We're talking to Nicola Kastner, who is the event strategy advisor for her organization, and she's also known as the event strategist, and obviously knows her stuff very well. I go back to wrap up with this initial point about budgets and the flat budget, which is where all this started. Do you ever see a point in our industries of events, trade shows, expos, conventions, where the budgets may do, because the pendulum always shifts, it's swinging all the time. Do you ever feel like, and even though this has been going on for decades, okay, that it might shift back and more budgets will loosen up and actually see money come their way? Or is it more of a trend with, it's going to be restrictive, and it may, even with the economic situations we're in right now, may even get more restrictive as time goes by? What's your gut tell you on that type of a question?
Well, I think, you know, I'm a marketer, right? Events sit in marketing in my experience when I'm talking about B2B corporation. And events represent 12% holistically of the marketing budget. Not just programs budget, the whole budget. And that's based on data from both IDC and Gartner. So marketing budgets have to cover a lot, including headcount. Headcount is part of that number, but just carve out 12% in events. That's a lot. That, you know, events are getting, they're the second highest investment level from a tactic or a channel perspective than the digital. And digital, I'm talking every part of digital, you know, from SEO, the website, you name it, email marketing, all of those different channels, that all wraps up into digital. Events is the next largest investment. So outside of people, of course. So, mm-hmm. So if you think about that, 12% of an entire marketing budget on our discipline, that's a lot of money. I don't see that we're going to get more of the pie. I'd like the pie to get bigger that we're getting a slice of, for sure. But, you know, that's a whole bigger complicated issue that talks about the value of marketing and the output of marketing and so forth. In order to keep our piece of the pie, at least, we need to lead with outcomes, we need to lead with impact, and we also have to think about how events tie into other marketing tactics. right? So, you know, a customer that's looking to buy a software product, for example, you know, they might discover the company through the peer reviews, they've downloaded some white papers, they might see it at a trade show, you know, fast forward, they become a customer. There's a whole journey of touch points, and saying that an event is the only reason that somebody becomes a customer or buys your product is ludicrous. That's like saying I decided to marry my spouse within 30 days of one dinner, just one, right? That's not how it works. So I think understanding how events connect to the customer journey, focusing on the outcomes, communicating the results is just as important as achieving them. That will keep our piece of the pie. Whether the pie will grow, I don't think our slice will grow, but I just hope the holistic pie does.
I understand the analogy. Of course, you're talking to a diabetic, so the pie gets a little touchy there. Wild little pie coming from Alabama, but no, it's totally understandable. You did touch on a point. I said it was the last thing, but I am interested in your take. And I think I read it on your website that, and doing this, if you're going to start your own event strategist company, you probably couldn't have done it at a better time than just after COVID, because you're able to pull all of what we suffered from. We did suffer back into that experience and that going forward. But, I noticed that you do strategize with both in-person, virtual, and hybrid. You do, and so your take on that is it'll be around a while, this combination of the three?
Yeah, I mean, there is 100% a place for digital. I don't like the word virtual events per se. I prefer to call them digital events. I think what's happened is the pendulum has swung so far the in-person way because we could. Right? We can now. We've been back to events and people are hungry to be together. The beauty of COVID, quite frankly, is the value of events has never been clearer.
Right.
It's, you know, they were most definitely missed in organizations. But I do think there is 100% a place for digital. I think what we did not figure out during the pandemic, and we still have not figured out, is how to design them in the right way to drive the right impact. Because if you think about it, events are bundles of activities that you stick together to maximize time and space.
Right.
But so you take all these bundles of activities and we move them online. That's what we did. But people act differently digitally, right? When you go to a department store and you're wandering through a department store, you might go to buy a dress, but it's feasible you could buy a couch because you browse, you wander. I know, because I've done it. When I'm on Amazon, I go direct to what I'm buying. I'm in, I'm out, I'm task focused, and I'm done. We haven't figured out how to enable properly for the task focus, I don't think, in digital events yet. And I hope we do. I wish I had the answers on how we do. I don't necessarily have those, but once we figure that out, I think we'll see a greater impact in digital. But they are certainly great for getting broad messages out, getting reach across audiences that you wouldn't necessarily be able to get to fly to a central location. Hybrid, you know, I'm a little bit on the fence about them, quite frankly. So you know, this DAO that I'm talking about on the one side where it's all in person, if the strategy is more led to in person, the people that are on the digital side of the experience, it's becomes an afterthought.
Right.
So with hybrid is double the work. Hybrid is double, if not more, expensive if you're trying to do a really great digital experience and a really great in-person experience. In order to make them both really effective, you have to invest a lot of time, energy, and effort, which we don't necessarily have of any of those things anymore.
Right.
So I'm I prefer, rather than trying to create the hybrid strategy around a specific event, I prefer to use the event as a content for content capture that will be reused in other ways, rather than just saying, here, we've got our event list, podcast, the content out to others.
The on-demand aspect.
On-demand, but not necessarily just on-demand, right? Because you can take, I'll use an example from myself. I went back to watch a session that had multiple panelists, and this was actually during COVID, and it was the return to travel, and it had four different panelists, and each of them were asking four different questions. I dropped off after 20 minutes, like everybody does with an online session, but I wish they carved that session up into the four blocks, right? Then I would have, oh, that was the question that I really wanted to know the answer to. I'm gonna look for that. So I think the post-editing of content on demand is critical and shouldn't be overlooked.
Definitely, I agree with you. I wanna go straight to where I want to find my information, just like Google, you know?
Yep.
Google that.
It's Amazon, right? That task focus.
Exactly. And that's what we are. We're task focused creatures. So good point. A great discussion with Nicola Kastner. I really appreciate you taking time. I hope we can do this again sometime. I know you've got a very busy schedule, and I hope you stay busy in 2024. And thanks for coming on and chatting with us today.
Thanks so much for having me.
We're going to take a quick break and come back and wrap things up after this.
Attention, trade show and event marketing professionals. Are you ready to take your face-to-face marketing expertise to the next level? Join more than 3,000 candidates currently enrolled in Exhibitor Group Certified Trade Show Marketer Program. CTSM is corporate America's top source of the industry's best trade show and corporate event training. CTSM certified trade show marketers enjoy expanded career opportunities, greater respect and authority in their organizations, and earn higher salaries than their acronym-free peers. Learn more, earn more. Visit ctsm.com today.
Great interview, Mike, and Nicholas got some great insights. And it was interesting for me. I didn't realize that the budgets have stayed consistent over the years. That was a little bit of a, I thought it had increased or whatever, but I think it really brings to her point of value and measurement. How do you really track some of these? And you can create that value that people want to come to. What's the real return for them? And I think data, again, the more we talk about it, we're actually working with Exhibitor at that level. And our executive roundtable, we're going to be bringing some of that in with Explorey in the area. How do we bring more measurements to this? And I think the more we bring that information to the corporate marketer, they can take with their team and make better educated decisions. And the budgets may go up then, we'll see. But it's also good to hear that it doesn't really tie to the consumer spending or their consent or their feelings of the world. So let's see what we can do to keep improving it. Bright information. So I'm looking forward to hearing more on her thoughts on that as we work with her at Exhibitor. So.
Yeah, she's a couple of years into this self-promoted organization of hers and going out there and preaching that sermon about how to take your event and move it up with the economical challenges that sit there for all of us as we go. And Exhibitor Live is one of those examples of a show that I close my eyes and I imagine this is many as 80%, maybe more of the exhibitors will have some type of experiential aspect in their booth. That's what I would like to see. You don't want a carnival. You certainly can't forget the fact that this is a business venture, right? I mean, we're a business organization, a set of them inside of a trade show, and you're out there promoting your products and services. But let's face it, experiential is a demand now. The CTSM world, the buyers, mm-hmm. the people who are going to pick and choose your products want to see what you're out there creatively doing with mm-hmm. your products. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I like what you're thinking about for your activation at Live, and I don't know if you've been ready to explore or present that yet, but you're actually creating an experience, and those are the things that are memorable, not only at the event that brings you customers at that time, but will continue to work on your brand for some time to come. And I think we shared on one of the other podcasts too, one of the survey questions we got back from last year is the CTSM's filling out the survey. They actually deselected a partner on the show floor because they didn't show up in a way that they felt was appropriate. They weren't doing the teachings that they were getting in the classes. And they were just showing up as, you know, sitting in the booth, maybe on their phones, eating lunch. I mean, all the things we shouldn't do at a trade show exhibit that we make fun of. And some of them were doing it. So we all have to take this lesson and learn from it and figure out how we're going to show up better. And I think it's even harder when you're in the business because, you know, if you're an event business, you're going to be much more critical of an eye on how your partners and that show up with it. So hopefully everybody does a good job with it, and we're excited about I'm excited about yours. I'm practicing. I'll just tell that to the listeners. I don't want to tell everybody what's going on, but I'm starting to work on it. So
we did release social this week on it yesterday, as a matter of fact. We have a professional, actually a pair of them. It's a man and a woman who are professional line dance instructors. And what we did, Mark, was we incorporated it into the exhibitor gamification that's going to happen. There's only a dozen of the show floor exhibitors who are participating in this. And there's for prizes that you can win by going around mm-hmm. and getting that check mark that you went through their experience and their that gamification. So you have to come to our booth and learn how to line dance. Now, at the it's the top of the hour for 15 minutes. So it's not a schedule killer. You can actually do this. And they're going to come in, and they're really fun people. We've already talked mm-hmm. about their strategies and how they do it. They get everybody involved. The aisles might be a little crowded, I'll go ahead and tell you, because they're not dancing in our booth. So that means that we have some excess space around the aisles where people are going to be doing their little thing. But it's only for a few minutes. But the idea is give the attendee something that they yeah. can take away besides what you're trying to preach to them on your business. Make an impact on them so that they remember your brand name. And we've been preaching that, Mark, for years now, even from Don and Mike. I mean, it's just experiential is king right now, along with value. And the two go hand in hand, in my opinion.
Yeah, no, we worked with Jim Gilmore and Joseph Pine and then Experience Economy for years. And that truly is where we're at. And it's only getting more intensified as people. We need to have an experience. And like I said, we're now tainted a little bit because the experience level has to keep being increased. But sometimes it's just the simple little things that still bring that shock and awe that makes a big difference. And I commend you for doing that. And I hope all the other exhibitors are figuring out a way to bring the Nashville theme together and entertain and give an experience for all of our attendees that are going to be there.
And for our competitors, don't copy us. Go be creative. Go do something else that you can, you know, make cakes. Go do something. Just, I don't know. I'm just kidding. But I'm sure everybody will be creative because that's what we get paid to do, you know, is to be in the creative world of events and trade shows. So that being said, we'll wrap this one up. And next week, really excited about next week's interview. Just finished that this week. Is a talk with someone that a lot of people in the industry know, the deputy director of the Anaheim Convention Center. Her name is Mindy Abel, and she's amazing. I had a fun time talking with her, especially about sustainability and what they are doing out in California with their organization. It's one of the main reasons, Mark, that they won the Convention Center Award for 1 million square feet or larger in the competition that your organization just had back in November. Mm-hmm. And she goes through a full-fledged presentation of why they're very strong on that as well as other aspects. So you'll want to make sure that you check that out next week here on the Exhibitor Now podcast. Any other final words before we close this one down?
No, I think they are doing a great job, and I'm looking forward to her walking through it, and our listeners should learn from it, because there is sustainability is one of the big issues that I guarantee it will be in the forefront in the next few years, and it's going to become an increasing part of all of our lives. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to that, and we've got some neat things coming, as we say. Hopefully next week I'll get a little more data from David and we can actually say what we can release and start to tease the people for attending with it. The numbers continue to grow. We're looking back to the 2018 numbers as we keep talking about. So it's going to be an exciting time, and on to Nashville. Here we go.
Absolutely. Yeehaw. We'll see you next week here on the Exhibitor Now podcast.
And remember,
the Exhibitor Now podcast. Give us 30 minutes and we'll give you everything you need to know now.